Hey everybody, this is Carl at Smallstep, and I want to talk about a few different terms related to Wi-Fi security, network security, that are often confusing and require some unpacking when you first encounter them. And this is specifically related to like enterprise network security. So we have WPA, WPA Enterprise. We have 802.1x, we have EAP-TLS, and I want to take these apart. Oh, and we have EAP-TTLS, and just like EAP in general. And I want to take these apart, unpack them a little bit, and talk you through them. And I think it'll help you have a better mental model for how network security works in an enterprise network. First of all, WPA. Wi-Fi protected access. WPA is a trademark. WPA3 is a trademark by the Wi-Fi Alliance. And, you know, Wi-Fi is a trademark. And these terms are part of a certification process. If you want to be Wi-Fi certified, if you're a manufacturer of access points or routers or any kind of Wi-Fi device, you want to be Wi-Fi certified, you have to meet certain security criteria, you know, implement certain protocols, and those standards are defined by WPA. So you've got WPA3 personal, which is usually for home Wi-Fi, and then you have WPA3 enterprise, which is usually for corporate, you know, bigger organizations, higher security. And they both have different security properties and requirements and authentication methods and things like that. So WPA defines all of that in the big picture, just for Wi-Fi networks. We're going to zero in on WPA 3 Enterprise. In the world of WPA 3 Enterprise, the way that clients authenticate is through a IEEE standard called 802.1x. And the reason it's an IEEE standard is that this is a protocol that works at the data link layer on the, you know, one of the lowest layers of the network. And the reason that's having to happen is that this is for authenticating clients to the network. And at this point, when you are connecting, you don't have an IP address yet. The client doesn't have an IP address. It doesn't have any of the higher layer IP niceties. It just has this low-level connection to the access point. And so IEEE 802.1x creates a container at that low level for authentication to happen inside of without an IP address. And 802.1x works on both wireless networks and wired networks if you're using enterprise security and you need to authenticate this way. The next piece of the puzzle is EAP. And EAP is a standard extensible authentication protocols. It's been around a long time, and it was originally used for dial-up connections, for like PPP point-to-point connections, adding an authentication layer to those connections. And then it's been just reused for Wi-Fi and wired connections on a LAN. So EAP is a suite of different authentication methods. There's about 40 different kinds of EAP authentication methods that you could use. And there's probably a handful that are actually widely deployed. Some of them you can use a username and password with. Some of them you can use certificates with. And there's different combinations as well. So EAP is just like a big picture, many different possible EAP methods are available. And EAP fits inside of 802.1x. So 802.1x is the container for EAP to happen and facilitates the EAP protocol inside of either a wired connection or a wireless connection. This all works in concert with a RADIUS server. And RADIUS, don't worry about what it stands for. A RADIUS server is an authentication server for a network. And RADIUS also has been around for a long time. And RADIUS works at this 802.1x level, and it handles all the different possible EAP types. You can configure it to connect it to an identity provider so that, like, people can use their username and password, and it looks it up in, you know, Active Directory or whatever, and make sure that you're a user. And then the Radius server just makes a determination of whether to accept or reject the authentication for the user. So this is a way of delegating authentication away from the access point to a separate server. And that's often needed in bigger networks, right? You might have hundreds of access points. You want one authentication server. So that's the Radius server. Oh, and in that scenario, by the way, when you are connecting to a network through a Radius server, the access point is just proxying that connection to the Radius server from the client. And so the amount of work that the access point has to do is very minimal, and it doesn't really have to know anything. It just has to know like which Radius server to point to, and it just proxies that traffic over to the Radius server. And then it will receive the response from the Radius server, like, is this client allowed on the network? And it will use that response to determine whether to move forward and help them allocate an IP address or disconnect that client. Okay, so we've talked about 802.1x, we've talked about EAP, and we've talked about Radius, and we've talked about WPA. The last thing I want to get into is just a couple of the specific EAP types that are available. So there is EAP-TLS, which is about the most high security Wi-Fi authentication method you could use. EAP-TLS uses mutual TLS to authenticate clients to a network. So the client has to have a client certificate, the Radius server has a server certificate, and they have to mutually authenticate each other in order to connect. This is sometimes confused with EAP-TTLS. So let's talk about that for a second as well. So with EAP-TLS, the only way you can authenticate to the network is with a certificate. There's no username and password ever. With EAP-TTLS, EAP-TTLS stands for tunneled TLS. So with EAP-TTLS, you don't necessarily need a client certificate. The first thing that happens is the client connects to the Radius server and does a TLS handshake to establish an encrypted session. So it's authenticating the server's certificate, but the client doesn't necessarily have to have a certificate. It could just be a regular TLS connection, server authenticated connection. And then inside of that tunnel, there's another authentication step that the real authentication takes place of the client. And that could be a certificate authentication with a client certificate, or it could be a username and password. There's a couple of different ways that that inner authentication can happen with TTLS. So TTLS, I mean, you can tell it's more complex than EAP-TLS. And one reason people deploy EAP-TTLS over EAP-TLS is if the client certificate has sensitive, like personally identifiable information in the certificate properties, then you would want that client certificate to not be shared over in plain text, which is how it works with the TLS handshake on EAP-TLS, right? You would want that certificate to be shared with the Radius server over an encrypted channel. And so you create that encrypted channel, that tunnel, and then you can share, the client can share its certificate that has PII in it. That's one of the biggest reasons that people deploy EAP-TTLS over EAP-TLS. So there's one more thing I want to talk about, which is this idea of an evil twin attack that's possible with this enterprise Wi-Fi setup. With an evil twin attack, an attacker could set up a network that has exactly the same SSID as the corporate network and a Radius server that then listens and tries to steal credentials from clients connecting. One part of mitigating this attack is using the server certificate on the Radius server. So clients can be configured a couple different ways for this. One way you can configure a client is you can say, here is a root CA, and the Radius server has to have a certificate that goes back to this root of trust, right? And that really helps because then the attacker would have to have a server certificate signed by an internal PKI in order to pull off the attack. And that was much harder to get that certificate and key, hopefully. So then the other option is that the Radius server could use a publicly trusted certificate on the server side. So it could just get a Let's Encrypt certificate and use that. In that case, the attacker can also get a Let's Encrypt certificate and use that and just put some random name on it, and they would be able to successfully pull off this evil twin attack. So the way that this is mitigated is that clients can be configured to with the name of the Radius server that they're expecting to connect to. And so if it's radius.example.com and it's configured in the client, then the attacker would have to get a certificate for radius.example.com in order to pull off the attack. And that's much harder to do. So, you know, this configuration of the server name on the client side is kind of less important if you're using an internal PKI, but it's still a good idea to do it. And it's more important if you're using a publicly trusted certificate in the Radius server, which is kind of like a simpler setup because then you don't have to send a root CA certificate down to all of your clients, right, for connecting to the Radius server. So that's all I wanted to share. I hope this has helped demystify some of these enterprise networking security terms for you.